I'm Al Gidari. I'm the Director of Privacy at CIS. It's a great pleasure to introduce Judge Smith to you all. Barbara introduced both Judge Smith and Judge Grewal a little earlier. Paul is now the Vice President and Senior Counsel for Litigation at Facebook, so he's run away from the bench. Judge Smith has been long on the bench and has a little longer to go before that clock runs out. We were going to do this with these chairs to your right up here, but we were afraid the judge would fall asleep. Some judges have been known to do that. Not Judge Smith, I could assure you.
I've had my quota of coffee, so I'm good.
We had dinner last night and talked about this being in the form of sort of an AMA, and Judge Smith said, well, what's an AMA? And we said, this is going to be sort of like your Reddit introduction up here. And he said, what's a Reddit? Because he was sure he had Reddit at some point before, and we're going to talk about it today. But this is going to be a conversation about how the judiciary deals with a lot of these novel surveillance questions. Judge Smith has told me in the past that he's not very technically oriented, but his opinions on location information, remote access to computers to conduct searches and the like might belie that a little bit. And I will point out that while Dan was speaking, Judge Smith leaned over and he said, there's at least four problems with that whole straw man. That's not going to work. So I think he may know more than he lets on here. Paul has known Judge Smith for a very long time, and I think together and with a number of other people whose names you've heard referenced here earlier have been in the vanguard of what's been described as the magistrate's revolt, the notion that a number of federal magistrates who sit, scratch their heads, and wonder what in the world did the government just put in front of me, ask me to sign, and are going to go out and execute. How does that actually work under the existing statutes that we're charged with ensuring we comply with before we sign it? And as a result of that, we've had a lot of really great forward-looking opinions, and Judge Smith has been at the vanguard of that, and we owe him from the privacy world a debt of gratitude for taking the time to do that instead of what a number of folks sometimes feel is more rubber stamping that goes on. And I can assure you, with the number of federal magistrates we've gotten to deal with, there isn't a lot of rubber stamping from folks like Judge Smith, so we're very lucky. Paul, I'm going to turn it over to you to ask a couple of questions, hopefully very embarrassing ones, of Judge Smith. And you don't have to pull any punches now that you're not bound by the rules of judicial ethics.
Thank you, Al. It's nice to know that I have a license to be unethical. Pleasure to be here with you all this afternoon, and it is not often that you get to meet with and chat with someone whom, in our little revolt, as it's been characterized, is really the Patrick Henry of the cast. And so, Judge Smith, thank you for allowing me to join you up here. The first question I wanted to ask was really a bit of a historical question. When you first joined the bench, I believe it was in 2004, correct?
Right.
What was the discussion? What was the conversation around issues like transparency and privacy? I mean, it was only 12 years ago, but in this world, that's a lifetime. I'm just curious if you could share with us kind of those early experiences you had when you first joined the court.
Well, first of all, thank you for inviting me and Al and Paul. This is really an honor for me to be here, the work you're doing here is very important. Before I answer your question, Paul, I want to especially thank my friend Al because this does partially answer the question. Back in 2004, there wasn't anything out there as far as giving us guidance as to how to interpret this bizarre, complex statute called the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, and so I did. and that was very frustrating. There weren't any published opinions, so much less Court of Appeals opinions, and Supreme Court opinions obviously were nowhere to be seen. So as Al said, before I signed off on something authorizing, I wanted to understand what it was I was signing and whether I had the power to do it. Not many people around that I could find that actually knew about things like ECPA or CALEA, but this is one of the world's leading experts on CALEA. Al was there, and he was at the scene. Others like my good friend Susan Freewald, Professor Freewald, had written some articles on this. So that was basically my starting point. And so that led me to be concerned about the fact that we need more transparency, because if you have somebody like me issuing an order, I'm still clinging very strongly to my flip phone. Believe it or not, I don't have a smartphone. So despite what Al says, I am technologically illiterate, especially compared to everybody in this room. But, you know, if somebody like me has to kind of chart their own course, that's a disturbing thing. So my whole point in writing opinions is getting it out there, starting the debate. And then that also led me to this whole conundrum about sealing the orders and gagging the providers so they can't tell their customers that the government's been snooping on their private or digital lives. And so that was kind of the starting point, I guess it was.
Well, we obviously have an interesting and broad mix of people here with different backgrounds. I think for at least some of our audience would be helpful for folks to understand what a magistrate judge does and what right. some of the first tasks you were assigned when you were appointed.
Right. Basically, we are federal judges. We're assigned to a district court. We've got authority and power to handle cases on the civil side, but one of our most important duties is issuing warrants and handling preliminary criminal matters. But the one thing we can't do is try a felony case, which is fine with me. But we are on the front end of investigations. And before cases actually turn into cases that are actually docketed on the criminal docket, there's a whole lot of investigation that goes on that courts have to play a role in. And that's what we do. And so we're on the front end. We're on the firing line for the new technologies that come out, new surveillance activities. We're the first ones to see it. And again, that's why I think it's all the more important that we tell people, you know, what we're seeing and get the public involved. So
for folks who have never visited a magistrate judge's chambers or come by looking for a warrant, perhaps it might be helpful or instructive to learn. How does an agent of the IRS or DEA or FBI or any other federal agency go through the process of getting a warrant? Where do they go? Who do they talk to? What papers are presented?
All right. Well, the agent actually is working with a U.S. attorney normally. They fill out what's usually a form, a search warrant application and a supporting affidavit, and they walk into chambers and they drop it off. And I guess some judges may allow the agent to come in and chat with them about what's in the affidavit and whether there are problems and that sort of thing. I typically didn't do that. I wanted to be able to review it without somebody looking over my shoulder so I could kind of concentrate and see, you know, what I thought needed to be done. So that's kind of the way it works. Now, one thing I think it's also significant to point out that Paul and I were talking about, depending on what city you're in or what court you're in, there may be more than one magistrate judge that works in that courthouse. And when that happens, we share the criminal duty among ourselves. There's always one magistrate judge on criminal duty in any court on a 24-hour basis in case there are emergency arrest warrants or things that have to be taken care of. And so if there's more than one magistrate judge in that district, we typically share rotate the magistrate duty. So in our district, there are five magistrate judges. We rotate the duty on a two-week basis. Paul, I understand when you're here, at least in San Jose, there were generally two,
That's right.
And one other. So that, and of course, the prosecutor or U.S. attorneys know they have the schedule as to what judge is on duty when, and that leads to, what's, I guess, impolitely known as judge shopping. A prosecutor, if he's got a particularly novel or perhaps a weak application, will know which judge is probably more likely going to grant it than not. Let's be honest. And in fact, if I were in the U.S. Attorney's office, I'd probably be doing the same thing. But it is a problem. It is an issue.
It's interesting. After a few years on the bench, I did notice that things were a lot quieter when I went on duty than they seemed to be for certain others. I just attributed that to vacation schedules and...
I'll give you an example. Just this last week, I was on the criminal duty, and Thursday and Friday, I got zero applications. And the judge who was on duty this week had an extra helping, for those first 3 days. So
just to be clear about all this, in this process of an agent looking for a warrant, dropping off the application, do you ever see the defense lawyer? Is there a defense lawyer?
No, there is not a defense lawyer at that point, or very rarely are there. Sometimes if there's a search warrant on an ongoing case or a case that's, it's already indicted or whatever, you'll know there's a defense attorney, but generally you won't. And so generally we, as magistrate judges, are the backstop there. There's nobody to argue the other side of the case.
Now, in chambers, as you're reviewing applications, these applications consist of a cover sheet, right, an affidavit. Maybe you'll get some other evidence, but typically it's the agent's affidavit, right?
That's right. That's right.
Do you tend to review those materials by yourself, or do you consult with your law clerks? How do you evaluate those requests?
No, I don't. That's not something that's easily delegable. It seems to me that's a decision that each judge has to make. So, I generally don't get my law clerks involved in that process, except to. What I've done, and of course, as part of the application, the government agent will submit an order that's written the way they would like it to read. I have developed over time, some things they ask for I don't grant, and some things they ask for I do. So over time I know what they're going to ask for, I know what I'm going to reject, and so I've come up with my own template for those orders, an order for customer information or subscriber information under 2703D. They will typically ask for location information, that sort of thing, that I typically do not give, except now historical information, now that the Fifth Circuit has corrected me on that. So I'll do my own order, but typically what I'll go to my clerk and I'll say, okay, this is a pin trap, pin register, trap and trace, fill in the phone number, and 2703D, give them customer information going back to a certain date. They will always ask for phone records or data, metadata, at least 60 days prior to the date of the order. I don't give them the full 60 days. I give them, whenever they have specific and articulable facts for that particular phone or device. So I try to limit them a little bit on their temporal scope.
Will you ever reach out to the agent if you have questions, or call the AUSA who's supervising the investigation?
I did that originally, and in fact, I can remember one particular day I had almost the entire U.S. Attorney's office sitting in my chambers, and we were debating the scope of the ECPA, and I was trying to understand how it is that I had authority to issue what they were asking me to do, and this is mostly on location information. And initially, and aside from that example, sometimes we'll have search warrant applications that are perhaps lacking in a particular, one particular item that needs to be specified that's not there, or maybe they got the wrong date or something like that. And I used to go back and say, okay, I will deny this, but I will accept it if you fill in A, B, and C, and no problem. Over the years, I've stopped doing that because it struck me as poor. I was kind of negotiating with a U.S. attorney, which didn't seem to me to be worthwhile use of my time. So I thought it was more productive for me just to deny it, you know. And that way, they're going to err on giving me more information, and I'm not going to have to argue with them about, okay, I have to have this. No, you don't. So I have a big red stamp that says denied. And that's the most fun part of my job, to be honest.
It is the part of the job I do miss perhaps the most. Well, you describe that feeling of having one or more, at least in this case, the entire United States Attorney's Office in your chambers. There is a feeling, right, that it's kind of you against the world there because you don't have a defense lawyer on the other side.
Well, that's exactly right. I mean, we're the backstop. And so, it's a heavy responsibility, I think. And so, you know, that's why it's kind of surprising to me that I get invited to speak to places like this. Because in my view, I was doing a job. That's what I'm supposed to do. That's what we're supposed to do. Now, obviously, we're busy judges. Some are busier than others. But, you know, we need to take time to get it right. And we take an oath to uphold the Constitution just like the Supreme Court justice. And so we are presented with something that violates the Fourth Amendment. In our view, then we can't sign it, or we shouldn't sign it.
So. Do you ever ask the Department of Justice or the U.S. Attorney's Office to submit briefing or provide some legal analysis?
Occasionally I do. The very first sell-side opinion I wrote, I actually drafted a memorandum setting out my analysis, and this was, I don't know if you remember, well, this is on prospective sell site, and the government had this hybrid authority argument that they were saying, well, we don't get this authority just from one statute, but if you combine provisions of the pen trap statute and provisions of the Stored Communications Act, and then you roll that into a bit of CALEA, then you mix it all up, and voila, we get what we claim we're entitled to. Anyway, I wrote a memo saying, kind of poo-pooing that idea, and sent it to the U.S. Attorney. They sent it to Washington, to DOJ, and to get a response, and then they wrote a reply, and that's when I first saw this hybrid authority argument, and I still wasn't convinced. About that same time, Judge Ornstein in Brooklyn was independently looking at the same issue, and so he came out with the very first decision on cell site tracking in, I think it was August of 2005, and then I followed up in October of 2005.
I remember reading some of your earliest work on that issue and thinking of it as a three-rail bank shot, right? You go here, you go there, and boom, there's probable cause. And just to dig in a little bit further on how you look at these applications and what questions you're asking yourself as you're trying to evaluate whether the U.S. government has sufficient cause to get the warrant. There's obviously the issue of probable cause, but what I think is the often overlooked piece of the Fourth Amendment in these discussions is the particularity requirement, right? How often are you seeing applications that may have cause for some type of seizure, but maybe not for everything that's being asked?
Right. That is very common. And where I struggle, and where it's more commonly than in other areas, is when they're asking to search computers. Because there'll be a crime, they'll probably have enough probable cause to justify a search of the computer, but I worry that, well, these days everything's on computer. How do I limit that search so that it's not just a fishing expedition where they go in and they want to look at everything on a computer, which is equivalent to libraries worth of information? I struggle with that. I really do. And I'm
Aberdeen.
Exactly. Now, some other magistrate judges, you talked about the magistrate revolt. There have been other magistrate judges, especially now retired Judge Paciola in D.C., that pushed back very extensively on computer searches like that and was getting down into the nitty-gritty with the government saying, no, you need to tell me your search terms. You need to show me, you know, that you're only getting the information that you have shown me is relevant to the crime and probable cause to get, And there was a lot of pushback back and forth. And he did some really heroic stuff on that, in my opinion. Of course, Judge Facciola has a really deep understanding of the way the computers and the internet work and all that, far deeper than mine. And that is, I guess, the thing. That's my regret. I'm not sure that I or even most magistrate judges have enough technical background to push back. Hopefully, as time goes on and we have more graduates from wonderful law schools like this, that we'll have more lawyers that are more technically competent that are rising to the bench, and so that they'll be able to push back on their own basis of knowledge.
Reading some of your opinions, it certainly strikes me that one of the things you seem to be concerned about, on top of the specific questions in front of you, is the extent to which other doctrines might essentially render the whole thing a moot or illusory exercise. I'm thinking mostly about plain view, for example, in the computer context.
Right. And that's a very, very difficult issue that, again, we need help. We need help from lawyers who know this area. You talked about, I mean, there are occasions when I have reached out to organizations such as EFF to give me amicus briefing to fill in the gaps in my technical knowledge, and that has always been a worthwhile experience, and frankly, I wish judges would do more of that. I guess part of the problem is that many judges who are less attuned to these issues than I am or don't know exactly what they're being presented with. You can get a very anodyne term like network investigative technique, or NIT. What the heck does that mean? And that's something that's easily glossed over, especially if a judge is busy that day. It might not really understand, okay, this is not an ordinary search warrant application. This is something they want to actually go in and install some malware on a computer somewhere and retrieve data, and there are a whole that opens up a whole new can of worms that judges need to be attuned to. We need to understand that we're not authorizing this massive general warrant searches that could potentially infect hundreds, if not thousands, of innocent computers, and so we need help from the bar there.
It's interesting, you know, we think about resources in this context in a lot of different ways, right? There are the resources, obviously, of the United States government. There are the comparably more limited resources of the United States magistrate judge who's being asked to evaluate these questions. And in my mind, one of the things I used to struggle with a lot was just trying to carve out and make sure that the time I was spending on these applications was adequate to the task at hand. In a complex, diverse, large federal district like the Southern District of Texas, on any given day or any given week, how many applications for Rule 41 warrants or D orders do you figure you see in a typical round of criminal duty?
That's a very good question. I think in an average day, and keep in mind that on a criminal duty, we will have a docket in the morning and a docket in the afternoon, and a docket of everybody, all the new arrests on federal charges are to be brought before a magistrate judge within a reasonable time, typically 24, 48 hours. So we're the first judicial official that they see. So that's primarily what we're doing in the morning and afternoon. In between, when we're off the bench, that's when we're considering these warrant applications. And I'll get, I'll say an average day is 10 to 12. I know on a Friday afternoon that there is one prosecutor in the Houston office that I'm going to get about a dozen pen trap orders. He waits until it happens every time. He waits. I joke to my law clerk, well, has USA blank submitted his pile yet? I said, no, not yet. But yeah, I know it's coming.
We had one of those in the Northern District. I used to call it the Friday afternoon run from Prosecutor X.
Exactly.
Because every time at 4 o'clock, you know you're getting that same
slug. Right.
Have you noticed in your time on the bench any trends in the sort of mix of requests that you're getting, either in terms of what process you're using, a warrant, a D order, and the like, or in the types of searches or seizures that are being requested?
Yeah, there's been a change in asking for what I call cell phone tracking information. We're now getting a new form of warrant application called a precise location warrant. And for some reason, the government draws a distinction between tracking you with a tracking device that they put under their bumper or whatever of your car, and tracking you with your cell phone, even though they both communicate by radio signal and they both satisfy the definition of tracking device under the federal statute. For some reason, they've taken the position that a cell phone is not a tracking device. So you have to have this other special warrant. They have conceded, which they didn't concede when I first took the bench, that if they want to get precise location information on a going forward basis, they have to establish probable cause under a standard warrant. So I've seen that trend more and more. Interesting, one of the other interesting trends I've noticed, and I don't know, Paul, if you saw this or not, but so many of these investigations, and of course the majority are drug cases, so many of these investigation applications we get will be, they'll want to get cell phone information that they generate the cause or justification from a wiretap. The district judges issue wiretaps. That's not something the magistrate judges do. But a wiretap generally requires more than just probable cause. You've got to meet a higher standard. And oftentimes, law enforcement argues for the need for pin trap and 2703D orders on the grounds that, well, these are kind of the building blocks of our investigation. We start with the lowest level of legal process in order to get some information, then we work our way up, and then eventually we'll get to the very top where we seek wiretap orders. That's not the way it works, at least in my view, in my district. I mean, it's going from top down. They already get the wiretap, and now they've got this massive drug conspiracy, so every time, you know, a new burner phone comes on, they need another order, but that's based on wiretap conversations that they have from the wiretap.
Yeah, it's interesting. When I first joined the bench, like Judge Smith, I did not come to this world with a extensive background in criminal investigations. I was a patent litigator for 15 years, and so on day one, when I'm sitting in my chambers literally unpacking the box, the first stack of applications arrives, and I'm, of course, flipping to the Fourth Amendment, flipping to CLIA, looking at some Judge Smith opinions to figure out what I'm doing. And I had an issue like the one you described on that very first day, or at least in that very first week, and at least one attorney, assistant U.S. attorney, tried to explain to me in a very helpful way, as he put it, that the T3, the Title III wiretaps were the gold standard, right? And that once you met the gold standard, you were essentially free and clear to pick up all the trap and trace and pen registers you liked. And I at least knew enough to say that didn't make any sense. And of course, over time, you start to develop a keener sense of how these things work.
Right.
On the issue of these different types of process, I think sometimes in the public conversation around these issues, one thing that gets lost is there are different standards that apply to these different requests, right? The wiretaps, of course, being at the very top, and trap and trace and pen registers being at the very bottom. When judges like yourself are wrestling with a request in one particular form subject to a lower standard as opposed to another, are you conscious of whether and how a request in one form might not meet the standard applicable to another, so that these debates are actually meaningful?
Yeah, to some extent. Now, when it comes to pin registers and trap and trace devices, that's not a difficult call, because all they have to do, the law enforcement just has to certify, we think this information is relevant, so they can get the phone numbers called and the numbers calling to a phone or emails in and out. So that's not a hard call. The 2703D orders are the standard. Is not probable cause. It's a little lesser standard. It's some call it a reasonable suspicion, but the language of the statute is that you have to show specific and articulable facts to reasonably believe that this information is relevant to the crime. So there has to be something specific and articulable. I do push back on those sometimes, because if they don't give me a date or a location or particular incident, and they just say, well, law enforcement has learned in investigating this drug trafficking organization that so-and-so is a huge supplier of methamphetamines and known trafficker, and so we know all this, so, you know, here's the phone he's using, and we'll, you know, give us the information. That's not going to be enough for me. Probable cause, I think, it can be a mushy standard sometimes. But generally, if the prosecutors have the information, if they really want it, because when I see, more often than not, when I get an affidavit supporting just a search an office or search a residence, I'll have 8 or 10 pages of actual hard, cold facts. And this, you know, what the investigation has shown to date, and there's really no doubt. And I suspect most of the time, if they really wanted to, they could give me that level of information. So I try not to let them get lazy on me, you know, when it comes to the lesser orders.
Well, that was certainly my experience that in that relatively rare, but you know, nevertheless significant situation or circumstance where I thought that there were sufficient facts presented to meet the lower standard, but not maybe the higher standard. And I didn't have the deny stamp that you had, but I really wish I had. I would just write it in, and I would send it back when the application came in, for example, in a different form, typically a Rule 41 warrant application. There were more facts there, and in fact, there was no real issue. And you know, my strong inclination or suspicion was that perhaps there was some concern about revealing some of those additional facts in the light of an ongoing investigation, but never quite know for sure.
Right.
Well, do you find yourself struggling to understand the basics of some of these technologies? You alluded to the fact that most magistrate judges have no background whatsoever in how do you even understand, for example, how a trigger fish works, or how do you come to learn what a particular encryption, how a particular encryption scheme operates?
I'll talk to Al. Actually, that's literally true with regard to triggerfish. Al was telling me back in his days working for a cable company that used to use one of those. This was back in the 90s, right?
We did call cell operations in New York City. We'd put a cell site emulator on top of a van and drive around trying to identify individuals who were cloning phones and selling them for $5 a minute on a street corner to the underserved community who couldn't afford a phone. And then because fraud was about 70% of revenue for that company, we'd then go to the police, and the police would roll up that, would respond very quickly and roll up that group. And of course, that training, if you will, led to the government seeing all sorts of opportunities to use that in other venues their own.
Right. So triggerfish is not a very new technology, really.
Not anymore, yeah, certainly.
Not anymore, yeah.
Yeah. That's for sure.
Yeah.
But I do think that even if the technologies are now relatively well known, the applications are always changing, right?
Yeah.
There are new circumstances in which they're being applied. And
well, the hacking warrant, I mean, the network investigative techniques to get in access to remote access to computers is new. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's an issue, too, that... Of course, I wrote the only decision so far dealing with that question, and it was interesting. The government was arguing with me about, oh well, Judge, we meet the standard. The searches here, when our FBI agents are reviewing the information on the screen in Houston, that's where the search takes place. And I said, no, it's wherever they're pulling the information from. And they pushed back really hard on that, and then I wrote the opinion saying what my view of it was. And then 2 months later, they're moving to amend the rules. So I guess I persuaded somebody.
correlation, causation.
Who knows?
We'll let everyone be the judge of that. Yeah. I think you had more than a little bit of influence on that one. I do want to just ask about how the public understands or can understand what's happening in chambers like yours and in courthouses like yours and the one I used to serve. We talked a bit initially about transparency around this. I take it back in 2004 when you first came to the court, there was just a standard practice. Most, if not all, the stuff was just placed under seal. Is that fair?
By that time it was. I listened very carefully to the earlier presentation about verifiable warrants and that sort of thing, and just a fascinating idea. And the one of the flaws there, unfortunately, is that when it comes to judges controlling or managing, or the courts managing their warrant dockets, I mean, that technology is 18th century technology. They don't, at least most courts don't, scan that information and put it on their CMECF electronic case management system like they do for ordinary civil cases or criminal cases. There's a big legal size, hardbound green book that the clerk actually manually writes in the case number, the PIN register, the technology that was around when the Fourth Amendment was adopted. And
I used to describe that as artisanal. To use a Northern California term.
Right. And so
here at Stanford, it's a business opportunity.
Exactly. Well, yeah, and our clerk's offices desperately need modernization. And one of the things we've discussed, my idea is that, you know, we need to make our warrant docket just as publicly accessible as the civil and the criminal docket is. And so obviously, you can't immediately disclose the warrant applications or the tracking device applications because you're going to blow the investigation. So some limited degree of sealing is necessary, but it doesn't need to be sealed forever. And it seems to me that even there is some information about that application that ought to be available to the public immediately. And my idea is, and I made this proposal to the AO that we adopt a warrant cover sheet that every agent, when he comes into the chambers, has to tick off. He basically answer five questions. What are they asking for? Is it a PIN register or a tracking device or a cell site simulator? What crime are they investigating? What agency is requesting this information? Do you need it sealed? If so, for how long? And then the last line would be what the judge did with it. Did he deny it? Did he grant it? Or did he modify it and then grant it? That seems to me information that I don't know why we need to keep any of that secret and for any length of time. That it would accomplish so much good. I don't know why we haven't done it yet. And one thing that bothered me coming in to starting the job was that, you know, was the lack of information given to the public about what we do with these applications. The public, for all they know, we're just sitting there with rubber stamps granting all these things. And I don't think that's the case. That is not the case in my experience. I mean, granted, some judges are more lenient than others, but I think all judges want to do the right thing. And most judges at some point or another have pushed back, but the public wouldn't know that without this information being out there.
It's interesting, right? If you look at the so-called revolt, I don't think it was ever explicit in anyone's written opinion, but there definitely is a tone, an underlying tone perhaps, of frustration among some of my former colleagues, your current colleagues, at the public perception of the magistrate judges serving as nothing more than rubber stamps. I think
exactly.
That's fair. Coming back to your idea about creating some paper trail or audit trail of what is happening in the federal courts with these applications, in some sense you're talking about creating metadata, right? It's anonymized. It doesn't relate to any particular investigation. is it your sense that the resistance, or to the extent there is resistance at all to this idea, is one just of habit and custom, or are there serious arguments that would weigh against this type of idea?
Inertia, I think, is the main stumbling block, and of course it will require, I guess, a little more work of someone in the clerk's office. But I've used that system in my chambers for the last year and a half, and the prosecutors don't seem to object to it. I haven't had any real pushback from them. And so I don't know. I don't know if there are any principled objections or substantive arguments about why we should keep this secret. It's just a matter of inertia. And I know right now the proposal is circulating among the various committees in the AO that weigh in on these things before we change the way we operate.
For those that don't know, would you tell what the AO is?
AO is the Administrative Office of the U.S. Courts that has the responsibility for managing the courts and the court system on the federal side, and that's basically, yeah.
So in terms of unsealing records after a period of time, I think it would be helpful for folks to understand a little bit better. How does that work? Does each individual judge who issues the order have the discretion to decide when an order should become public? How does that all happen?
Each judge does have discretion. It starts with whether or not the order to seal is going to be indefinite, or if you're going to set a time period on it. Unfortunately, we have a practice, or had a practice, and probably still prevalent, of judges just sealing these orders until further order of the court, which is an indefinite sealing order. As a practical matter, if I do that, I will never see that order again. There's no reason for it to come back to my desk, and so unless somehow I keep track or calendar it to think to go back, it's going to stay sealed, stay secret. Long after any justifiable need for it to do that. So I typically put a time limit on how long these orders stay sealed. And I think there's really a First Amendment problem, too, with these issues, with an indefinite sealing order, because indefinite sealing means there's going to be a gag order on the provider indefinitely. And there's a serious First Amendment issue there. Just seems to me, you know, judges ought not to be violating the First Amendment.
Well, I think that's at the very heart of the case Microsoft filed in the Western District of Washington challenging those types of orders.
Right.
Well, I want to make sure that we have time for questions, and I don't want to overstay our welcome, so.
I see everybody getting up and going to the mic. Remember, this is a judge. He does have contempt power, so be careful.
I'm out of my jurisdiction over here.
Your Honor.
Right, left. Go ahead.
Thank you. I actually clerk for John Hannum in the Eastern District, so I think I can do the OAs for you. My question is, have you contemplated or been seeing any of the smart building kind of discovery that could go on? We have sensors in all these buildings. They're telling us lots of things. You've talked a lot about seeing cell phone and computer orders, but are you seeing any building system orders yet?
I haven't seen any of those. And you're right, it does seem to me to be a fruitful area for litigation.
Discovery.
Of course, again, you know, they may be going to some other judges instead of me. I don't know.
Well, and the flip side is, as complex as you see understanding these orders for your purposes, are you seeing a need for the public defender to have some elevated, you've let the cat out of the bag, you've let the evidence in, and now somebody has to deal with trying to get a defendant protected with that?
The public defender, I guess, is they're in a little different position. I mean, I don't think it's fair to view them as the protector of the public or the general public's interest to know. I mean, their responsibility is to defend
correct
their client, and so if they can attack this type of evidence. They can minimize. I mean, their view is not necessarily privacy protective. So, although I know they're supportive, I suppose, on if it comes to a Fourth Amendment violation. But if the evidence comes in, then they're going to do their best to attack it.
I think that's right.
Thank you, Your
Honor. Yeah.
Both of the panelists referred initially in their discussion, perhaps somewhat lightly, about judge shopping. And then later, near the end of the conversation, there was a reference to Judge Smith's decision perhaps inducing the changes to Rule 41. So it seems to me the obvious question for both panel members is, to what extent are the amended Rule 41 provisions going to induce district-wide forum shopping?
Boy, that's a good question. I really think that it was a rookie prosecutor on that case that brought that hacking warrant decision to me, or application to me. I don't. I've learned behind the scenes that that wasn't intentional. So I don't know. You want to answer the other part of that?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of whether or not the amendments themselves would induce further shopping, I think one would have to expect that in an adversarial system, the government, just like the defense lawyer, if and when they appear, will play every rule to his or her advantage. And to the extent we have seen, as I think your question suggests, this phenomena play out within a district, it would be somewhat naive not to expect that same phenomena would play out across districts as a result of the amendment.
Yeah. And just to be clear for people who don't know, Rule 41 is that rule under the rules of criminal procedure that permits a warrant to issue. And in the case of the amendment that we're talking about, it allows for a remote computer search to be conducted outside the district and the results of which to be read inside the district. And through the process by which that rule gets changed, the Supreme Court approved those changes through the Rules Committee, and absent congressional action, that change will go into effect December 1st, I guess it is,
end of
this year. And so that's a fairly interesting question about how frequently we'll see those and whether judges will even know that it is that type of an order or not, because there isn't anything that suggests they actually have to detail that in the application, I think.
Yeah.
So,
go ahead. To what extent and how often do you run into parallel construction in the applications for search warrants, for example?
I don't know, to be frank. And, you know, keep in mind generally that magistrate judges don't actually we don't try felony cases, and we can try misdemeanor cases, but I doubt very seriously if there'd be a parallel construction issue there. But in terms of the applications that we see, and I guess for those of you, you know, that probably most familiar with the term parallel construction, that means devising another source for the evidence that's legitimate to disguise the fact that the information was gained illegally up front. I honestly don't know. I don't know, Paul.
I don't know either, and it's a.
But I assume it's of concern to you, and you look with a sharp eye for that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good question.
Hi. You mentioned that you are beginning to see a lot of warrants for hacking or NIT, network investigatory technique. I was wondering, based on the applications you both may have seen, how often did you perceive there to be a legitimate need for law enforcement to hack in order to get that information? Or was it just another one of those, like, let's just find out as much as we can?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, due to proliferation of encryption, there may be, like, the most vulnerable endpoint is the user device. But at the same time, in your experience, has that actually been, like, the resort that law enforcement needed to in order to get whatever they wanted in their investigation? Yeah.
To be clear, I haven't seen that many of these applications. In fact, there may have been another one I've got, and I pushed back a little bit, and then they withdrew it. So the one I did see, I denied, and part of the problem was as you suggested, although there's clearly probable cause. I mean, this is an identity theft kind of case, but they hadn't done everything else or anything else that they needed, really, to, even though they didn't know where the computer was that was attempting to access this person's bank account. There was other information that they could have gotten before they actually, go to the extent of installing malware, activating the camera so they can locate the person, that sort of thing. So, but that was, I don't know that anybody's seen a lot of these applications. I haven't.
I have not either. There's another important issue that your question raises, which is this idea of exhaustion, right? So when it comes to wiretaps, Title III wiretaps, there is explicitly a requirement that the government establish that essentially they have no other reasonable means by which to get at the content that they're interested in. At least as I understood Rule 41 and 2703D and the like, there is no such requirement when it comes to those lesser forms of process. And so so long as there is probable cause, it would seem to me the government would have no problem establishing grounds to secure access.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for speaking with us. You said a little earlier that sometimes prosecutors are reluctant to share more details than they think they need to. You also spoke about technical terms like network investigative technique. Do you ever feel like the facts that you're being presented in a technical, in a computer-related case, are deliberately obfuscated to make it harder for you to critically analyze them or to make it more difficult to make a reasoned assessment about what the government has found or the processes they intend to use to find more information?
I'll go first if you like.
Go ahead.
Give you time to think of a better answer. I can't say I ever had a strong sense in any particular case that someone was out to obfuscate the truth or to otherwise mislead me with generalities or ambiguities in the applications that I saw, the affidavits in particular. In fact, I will share my own experience, and it's just one former magistrate judge's, maybe a current one has a different view. Much more common was actually the opposite, which was essentially not maybe a deliberate effort, but a reality that I was being flooded with so much information and so much background, it was very difficult for me as a lay judge to understand what was material to the question that was presented and what was not.
Yeah, and sometimes the problem is the agent, him or herself, doesn't understand the technology. And so even if you brought the agent in to say, okay, tell me about this network investigative technique and how is it going to work and is it going to invade other or infect other computers? Tell me why it's not a general warrant. They'll say, well, it's a program that was developed and, our specialist in this area, and so they don't know any more about it than I do. So or than they put on the affidavit. So they may not know themselves. Now that doesn't mean that somebody in their shop doesn't have that information, but they're not providing it.
That's very true. And of course, the FBI, among others, has substantial resources, quite talented people who work on these issues day in and day out. Your typical magistrate judge, though, will see applications not just from FBI agents. I used to enjoy, frankly, the visits from agents from the Department of Agriculture or the Postal Service or these other parts of the federal government that can request these types of process. And I think in those agencies, the level of sophistication may not be quite where the FBI is at,
right,
through no fault of their own.
Right. Good question.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. I think I speak for all of us to say that we find this an extremely enlightening discussion.
Good.
Are there any changes to the standard forms that you can think of to encourage particularity in the requests that come through? Do you see that as an area of improvement, and what would be the process to achieve that improvement?
That's a good tough question. We do have standard forms that again are generated out of the AO, the administrative office. But generally, we don't get those forms until after there's been a kind of a vetting process, and it'll take several years before they actually filter down. We just recently, or at least I say recently, in the last couple of years, got a standard form for tracking orders, tracking devices, and then they also have a standard order for technical assistance to fill those out. In terms of the specificity for meeting the probable cause standard, I'm not sure a form would help that very much, because each case is going to be a little different. But the more that can get standardized, the better, I think, because it speeds the process. It makes it more efficient. I mean, I'll tell you right now, I mean, there are various standard forms that are used by different agencies, say for 2703D or pen trap orders, and many of them are like 20 pages long.
At least.
And I know that I only have to go to page 17 to look at the one paragraph that will tell me whether I'm going to grant it or not, because the rest of it is just boilerplate that I've read for years that sometimes I agree with and sometimes I don't. But I know that the specific and articulable facts are generally only going to be one paragraph buried in the middle. So,
just if I can add a point or two on particularity, because I think it's a very important issue you raise. I would start with perhaps the obvious point that, as I mentioned earlier, the particularity requirement is in the Fourth Amendment, and I think it often gets overlooked that it is as important a clause to that amendment as the probable cause clause. The second thing I would say is that it is the government's burden in requesting a warrant to establish particularity. I don't think it's the job or the role of judges like Judge Smith to have to push back and identify and explain what would be particular or properly scoped to the probable cause that's presented. So my own view is that if that particularity requirement is not met, the outcome is pretty straightforward. Application rejected, and you move on from there.
To add just a little bit of clarifying detail, my understanding is that many of the requests for customer data that the companies in the Silicon Valley receive oftentimes only specify an account identifier and oftentimes lack any sort of dates or particular features in the account that are specifically being requested.
Yeah, in my standard order, I have a line for a date to fill in. I don't give them just indefinite time periods or, you know, for the length of the life of the account. You know, I tie it to what it was they got their probable cause for.
Yeah, I just want to add to that because I do think that over time, that problem has become, well, at least was less prominent for me at the tail end of my term in terms of requests coming from the United States government. But there's an important feature that we don't talk often enough in my view, which is that an increasing volume of these requests that are coming into companies like Facebook through chambers like Judge Smith's are coming from outside the United States pursuant to the MLAT or Mutual Legal Assistance Treaty process. And so if a prosecutor in Burkina Faso or Ireland or Australia or wherever we might have a treaty wants a request, they have access in the same way that a U.S. attorney has access. They often, in my experience, are less attuned to the particularity issues than I would like. And of course, the DOJ is supposed to manage that process and hopefully correct those issues, but that doesn't always happen in the way it should.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'd say one thing, Judge Smith had a number of folks from the private sector come in and do some training for the federal magistrates, and the so-called any and all warrants, the interesting thing is the judges think they're signing one thing, but the providers, when they get them, are reading them very, very narrowly. So even though they may be very broad, when it's so-and-so at Facebook or Gmail or whatever, most of the providers are looking at one service, not the 180 services that are offered or may be used by somebody. And then the government can come back and say, well, I didn't get the Google Docs with the email, why not? And it's because, well, it's read as very narrowly. And that soft law is sort of one of the really interesting aspects of technical assistance in responding to warrants. No. Go ahead.
Hi. I had two things. One is about the ex parte process, which you were talking about earlier, and the other is about privacy consequences from more routinely unsealing warrant applications and affidavits. For the ex parte process, it seemed kind of implicit in what you were saying and in the earlier question that it's kind of concerning that you only hear from the government all the time and that there's no one on the other side. And I remember certainly with the FISA court, there was all of this discussion about creating, this would obviously be a very big change at the district court level, but creating a public advocate who would oppose or question process and not someone who's a defense attorney representing an individual defendant or an individual suspect, but someone who's sort of there all the time, who's somehow bound to secrecy, who says, I disagree with this, I think this is improper. So I guess one question, granted that it would be quite a big change to the way these things work, is whether that would be useful or feasible at the district level. And I also have a question about the privacy part.
Okay. I'm not sure whose budget would that come out of. That'll be the practical problem. Mm-hmm. Secondly, I don't think it's certainly not necessary in every single case for a magistrate judge to consult or to get assistance to understand what's being asked for. My view is any assistance that can shine light and help me understand what I'm signing is great. And so sometimes I'll seek it out. I'm not sure. I guess the benefit of the process that FISA court has is they have somebody on standby, or I guess my understanding is a group of individuals that are qualified to provide that type of advice, and I guess they have to be, they have a clearance. Yeah. So interesting idea. I'm not sure in practice how it would work.
I do think that the pragmatic considerations are important. We tend to talk about, because this is the world that we come from, the federal court system, but of course most of the action in the criminal universe in the United States is at the state court level, and those courts have a very different volume and very different financial outlook from the federal courts, as tough as it is for federal judges like Judge Smith. So I think there are practical considerations. There's also a separation of powers issue, I think, ultimately, right, that needs to be resolved before you start inviting in other parties into the Article III, Article I process.
And I was just thinking, in terms of more and more records becoming available on PACER, there was a lot of privacy concern about the things that tend to already end up in trial records that show up on PACER, famously Social Security numbers, other kinds of personal details. It seems to me that the very particularity requirement that we've been hearing about means that the warrant affidavits are sort of inherently full of personal details every time. If they're not, they're kind of improper. And so it seems very valuable to try to think about how these things can become more regularly unsealed and more regularly available. But it seems like that may create its own family of privacy concerns for this reason, that those things just tend to be full of sensitive personal details.
No question that there would be personal information that could be disclosed. I think the vast majority of that problem can be handled by redaction, though. And to be honest, things like, say the government is coming using a confidential informant, rarely do I see a name attached to that in the affidavit. It's CS1 or CS2. Our federal our rules of procedure now require that Social Security numbers never be published as part of a document. You publish the last few digits. Age and financial account numbers are not supposed to appear in documents that are on the public public docket. So
it's a really good point. I think one of the reasons why, Judge Smith's proposal about creating some aggregate anonymized data about what's happening in his chambers at least addresses some of those concerns. But you're right, if we're going to be posting these applications online, hopefully we'll be thinking about the implications cutting the other way.
Yeah, very good question.
Thanks.
I know we're well over time, but quicker questions will be quick in answers, and there is a reception pending.
Yeah, there's booze out there for us.
Yeah.
What I was going to suggest is just, I have a quick question, let Irina go, and then Carl, and then you guys can respond to what part you want of it quickly, and then we can wrap up if that's all right with you all.
Sure. We'll take all three questions at once.
Okay, so my question is, how can we help the magistrate bar understand the technology and the legal nuances better? because not everybody has an Al to call. And even if everybody had Al's number, Al doesn't scale. He's a sort of Al Gidari as a service. I think that would be a really good business. But there's only so many Al's and Susan Freewalds and stuff. So what can we as academics do to help the magistrate bar? Irina, and then Carl, and then we're going to wrap up.
Well, kind of along with that and the question right before me, in IP litigation, judges can appoint their own experts, right, when they feel like they're out of their depth. So it seems to me like rather than waiting for the development of tech-savvy lawyers who will rise through the ranks and become magistrates, because that's a long time from now, there could be something similar where there's maybe some kind of a panel of technical experts that magistrates are encouraged to reach out to, so it doesn't have to be this ad hoc, I happen to know somebody, and they've sort of embedded it, everybody agrees that these are the experts who would know what to do. Not really a question, but sorry. I was about to ask something similar to what you did.
We now have insulin pumps that can encrypt messages, eyeglasses that can encrypt telephone calls, and soon we're going to have brain implants. Is there at some point that this equipment becomes subject to the Fifth Amendment?
Great question.
Boy, that one's yours.
I thought you were going to ask if judges become obsolete, but I don't think so.
We don't want that.
Why don't you go ahead first? You can pick the one you like best.
As far as the how do you help magistrate judges, with the technology, there is an entity called the Federal Judicial Center that conducts an education program for magistrate judges. They conduct a workshop for magistrate judges twice a year. They also set up courses on various discrete topics to educate magistrate judges. And so it would be wonderful if an institution like Stanford and your group here could hook up with the Federal Judicial Center to provide seminars, not just to attend our workshops, but standalone seminars for us to come attend out here to educate us, because there's a crying need for that, and that would be wonderful. That would be a great idea. I'm going to let you handle the Fifth Amendment.
Only thing I can say about that is that this is not sort of speculation about the future, right? We are already there. Courts are already wrestling with questions of whether or not individuals can be compelled to open up their phones or provide personal information that would allow access to the wealth of information in our devices. So your question is quite timely. This is not something to think about for the next 10 or 20 or more years. So I'll leave it at that and say, excellent question. Stay tuned and let's enjoy some of that booze outside. As Jennifer.
Thank you, judges.